Calvary, who is now Savior and Lord of all, King of kings and Lord of lords. And we thank you that that day that we call Christmas Day, hallelujah, a Savior was born for us. And we give you glory and praise his name. Amen. And now we're going to pick up the tempo just a little bit, born on that day we call Christmas Day. Amen.
Breaking the silence into the chaos you came. Born in our likeness, held in the hands that you made. For our deliverance, your promise was given a name. Emmanuel.
Today is the third Sunday in Advent, December 13th, unless I'm missing the date. Is today right. The 13th?
It's the 13th.
Okay, good. The prophets not only proclaimed that God would send his son into the world, but they also foretold the rejoicing that would accompany his coming. The hearts of men, women, and children were filled with joy and gladness at the realization that his promise drew near. Today, we relight the candle of expectation, recalling God's promise to send a Savior to his people. As we relight the candle of preparation, we remember how John the Baptist prepared the way for Jesus. Now, as we light the candle of proclamation, our hearts are filled with joy as we proclaim that his advent will soon take place.
Amen.
We rejoice in the advent of the Son of God and await the day when he will return. May our lives be filled with joy as he guides us in proclaiming his truth to those around us each day.
Luke 2:13 says, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel praising God and saying what? Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill to men. Let's stand together as we sing.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly
triumph of the skies with angelic Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord, long desired, behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb, veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity.
The wonderful thing about Christmas carols is that they tell the story of salvation is what they do. They tell the entire story of salvation, and I love Christmas carols for that very reason. And this is one of those wonderful Christmas carols that tells us all about the fact that Jesus came in the flesh. It said, veiled in flesh, the Godhead. See, we see God veiled in Jesus Christ. You see, the veil was his flesh. Incarnate means come into flesh. So Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, came in the flesh like you and me, okay? He became us. He was born as a baby. He sanctified all of life, every aspect of our lives, from birth to death and our resurrection. Hallelujah. Come on, church. Act like it's Christmas time. Forget about what's going on out there and get excited about the fact that Jesus has come to earth. God reigns in heaven today, and all is right with God. Hark the herald angels sing. Those heralds, they proclaim the good news that for unto you is born this day, a Savior, which is Christ or Messiah, the anointed one, the Lord. Amen. Now, this is what this Christmas carol is talking about. They're proclaiming that. And one of these days, hallelujah, one of these days, very soon, I believe, Jesus is coming again. He's coming again, and he's going to resurrect everyone who's believed in Jesus Christ. And we're going to join him. Oh, hallelujah. Then we're going to echo back the song of the angels saying, peace on earth, because Jesus is going to reign King of kings and Lord of lords. He's going to set up his kingdom on planet earth. And let me tell you, it doesn't matter what's going on in this whole world. When Jesus comes again, when it's all said and done, Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. He is Lord. So let's sing, knowing now, hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. I preach. Okay, I'm not preaching now, but I will in a minute. Okay, but I preached from Zechariah last week. I'm going to continue today. The horn of salvation and the sunrise from on high has visited us. Hallelujah. So hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings. Risen with healing in his wings. You need a touch from God today? Come on, receive it. Mild, he lays it. He said he did not think equality with God was something to be grasped, held on to, but he laid it aside. He laid aside his glory. Born that man no more may die. Hallelujah. We have eternal life in Jesus Christ. Born to raise the sons of earth. Born to give them what? Second birth. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, sing it out.
Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings. Risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by. Born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth. Born to give them second birth. Hark the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated. You may be seated. Amen. Whew. Okay, didn't mean to get so excited there. Actually, I did. Right, Dave? I did. You can't but get excited about this fact, church, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. What good news. Let me tell you, it doesn't matter what's going on around you. Coronavirus can't keep Jesus down. Hallelujah. An election can't keep Jesus down. Hallelujah. He has risen. He has risen indeed. You can't but think of Christmas without thinking of the cross, without thinking of the tomb, without thinking of the second coming. He ascended on high. He ascended on high, and he is what? He is giving gifts to men. He is giving gifts to men. And we celebrate him today, and we praise his name. Whew, okay. You feel better being in church today? Amen, amen. And we're so thankful that our church continues to function in all of its ministries. And we thank God that we are not shutting down and we're not stopping doing what God has called us to do. Amen? We give God glory for that. Well, there are a number of prayer requests as we go to prayer this morning. Again, if you feel like coming or gathering around the altar, feel free to do so. If you want to be anointed for any reason, a special touch, or if you want to be anointed for someone that's mentioned here today, please sit at the front pew so that we know, okay, that you want to be anointed, and then our intercessors will come. But would you take your bulletin, and you'll see the prayer request right here, and there are a lot of them. Let me just quickly run over them because there are a number of them. We do want to continue to be praying for Frank. He is at home. He is rehabilitating. It's going to be a long path for him, about the next 10 weeks, and it's going to be a long, long path of recovery. So let's be praying for him as well as Meredith as she continues to care for him, especially during this season. Let's continue to pray for Denise's continued healing, accelerated, right, Denise? Accelerated, miraculous touch, right? God has touched you way too many times to give up on you now, right, Denise? Isn't that good? Amen. So we're going to be praying for that. And Betty's here again today, and we have good news, don't we, Betty, about Joe? Isn't that good? Joe is on his way to recovery. He is now in a regular room. Is this good news, huh? Last week we were really, really praying and hoping, but God is in control. Yeah, Betty. Yeah. Joe. That's your other brother. Yeah, that's right. He is better. He does. Now, we just want to know, can he get phone calls and can he talk on the phone? Okay, so now's the time now, guy. Yeah, now he wants to talk. And if you know Joe likes to talk. See, look at that. But we knew better, didn't we, huh? We knew better. It was serious, 5 bypasses around stents and so forth. We know that. But let me tell you, we've had a lot of people go through that. You know, actually, I believe his weren't bypasses. They were just stents, right? Yeah. Well, you remember Jess. I think Jess had 5 bypasses. And look, God kept him alive, right? Amen, for a long time. So we praise it. So call Joe, talk to him on the phone, and I'm sure he would love it, okay? Okay, no, I'm talking about all of us. So get on the phone, talk to him, and let him know you're praying for him, love him, and appreciate him, okay? So we'll get you that number as soon as we can. So continue to pray for Joe. Let's continue to pray for Chuck. As you know, he had a real bad episode. We thought it was heart. Then we thought it was just an equilibrium thing. Now we know that he had 2 strokes, okay? 2 strokes. So he will be, I think he's coming home. He was. Okay. Okay, so a little long recovery, so let's be praying for Chuck. Total healing, restoration, again, accelerated healing, okay, so let's keep him in prayer. You know, I was just thinking, Brother Joel, I was thinking, this is the third Christmas that your family was reunited, okay? Can you believe it's been that long already, 3 Christmases? But you know what I want to see? You know what I'm going to say? I want them to get here. It's time that Uganda gives up your family and gets them here to America. So many others are coming. Others are coming from all parts of Africa. I say now is the time to get that family over here from Uganda, right? So let's really, really be praying for that. Stephen, you gave us really good news yesterday. Do you want to just quickly share about your dad? This is great. Right. Wow. Amazing. We have prayed and prayed. You've been anointed. We just really believe God's going to continue to touch this man. And again, let's lift up his parents, Denny and Mary Jo, for their salvation. Okay, that's what we want more than anything. Jan, Alyssa's mom, needs healing for her memory and such, okay, numbness and things of that sort. Her identical twin, some of you met Sarah, I think, in the past, and her husband, Carlos, be delivered from the bondages. Listen, how many of us have family members who are in bondage, huh? Oh, my goodness, all of us do, right? There's all kinds of bondages, right? All kinds of bondages. But let me tell you, the name of Jesus is what sets people free. He breaks every chain. Every chain can be broken. Amen. Let's lift up Elaine. She's really, really struggling. She texted Judy this week, and she really feels like now's probably time she's going to have to get a feeding tube in. It's just really, really hard for her to eat. She aspirates so much from eating. And so let's just really be praying for that God will touch her. Lift up Sandy Huffman's family, son-in-law's family in Florida. The family got COVID, aunt 92, daughter and so forth. Son-in-law, Dennis, did pass away. So let's really be praying for this family. We want to lift up Hanan. She was in the ER last night. They admitted her. That's Samuel, Cody's wife. She's due just like the week after you are, Alyssa, okay? But she had really high blood pressure. And so they're watching that, so be praying for her. Sam asked for prayer for her. And there are, you know, there are a number of people that are not feeling well. I just want to just say something here. Don't think that just because somebody has a cold or runny nose or a cough or whatever that it's COVID. Please, please, guys, you know, I mean, listen, you know, let's just be sensible here. You know, I mean, this is allergy season, this is flu season, this is cold season. You know, just because somebody has some symptoms, that doesn't make everybody have COVID. This is what they've done to us. They have conditioned us to think that, and we are not going to give in to that. So let's not pass judgment. You know, so people are really, really fearful that they say they're sick or whatever. Oh, got COVID. Well, you know what? There's also a 99% survival rate of COVID. Okay, that's not the case sometimes with the flu. So let's just be reasonable here. Okay. But there are a lot of people that are not here today because they chose to stay home because they were not feeling well. That's fine. That's what you need to do. If you're not feeling well, if you're sick or whatever, stay home. But I'm stuffy this morning. I've had allergies all week, you know. I don't have COVID, you know. I am just having an allergy problem, okay. So just be praying, you know, for our people that, you know, God does touch people. God needs to touch our people. But most of all, let's just pray that this spirit of fear that has bewitched the globe, that the spirit of Almighty God will break that. Amen. That's what we need to pray, that it'll be broken. Amen? That's what we need to pray. Okay? So there are lots of needs in our midst, but I just want to give that word of encouragement to you. Spirit of fear, you know, I mean... The enemy uses fear as a tactic, and we're not going to give in to it. Meredith sent me a note this week with her offering, but I just love it. God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. Amen? And aren't you glad that God is indeed good, and we praise his name today. So I want to encourage you to stand with us this morning as we sing this beautiful prayer chorus, not a Christmas carol, but I just thought, wow, what better way? The cradle always looks to the cross. Amen. So let's come to the cross this morning.
Your arms are
Jesus, we come to the cross today. We come to the cross because without the cross, there would be no way.
That's right.
There would be no way. We would be lost and stuck in a dark, dark world. We would be stuck in our sin. Death would overcome us. Darkness would overcome us. But God, what you did on the cross for us, that opened up a way for salvation. Yes, and for not only our salvation, but for your spirit,
that's
your
right.
Holy Spirit, your Ruach HaKodesh, to come into us so that we can be transformed and that we're no longer captured by the things of the world, we're no longer captured by the pain around us, but we are captivated by your love, we are captivated
yes,
by
Jesus.
Your forgiveness, and that your light shines through the darkness. And God, no matter what we face today, God, we know that you can do all things. And God, the scripture came to mind, and it says, the people who walk in darkness will see a great
Amen.
Light.
Hallelujah.
Those who live in a dark land, the light will shine on them. And maybe right now, some of us are living in a dark land. Maybe
yes,
some of us
right.
have been walking through the valley, through the darkness, God. But you have a promise at the end of that place that your light shines.
Amen.
And that we see that light coming through the darkness. And as we get closer and closer to you, Jesus, that light shines brighter and brighter. We thank you for brightening our path, for illuminating
yes,
our path so that we can walk on that straight and narrow path, because your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. God, no matter what we face today, thank you that you are with us. We have so many needs, Lord. We lift up all the people that Pastor Joe had mentioned. We want to especially lift up Betty's brother, Joe.
Thank
we want to lift up Chuck, God. We thank you, God, for healing them. We thank you, Lord, for being with them, for using them in a mighty way at the hospital, because we know at the hospital
thank you, Lord.
There is so much darkness in there.
Yes, Jesus.
And that your light overcomes the dark. So thank you, God, that you have put them in a place for such a time as this, Lord. We thank you, God, for healing, continuing to heal Denise and touching her, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
And for that accelerated healing, like Pastor Joe proclaimed. And we also thank you for the quick healing of Frank, who has exceeded expectations of, and Joe have exceeded expectations of healing from what the doctors have said. God, we thank you for each person in here today, Lord, who is facing something, that they would know that they are not alone, God, that they would know that you are with them and that you will never leave them. You will never forsake
that's
them.
That's right. Hallelujah.
And that, God, when we forget that sometimes and we try to do things on our own, we worry and we get fearsome, but your perfect love casts out fear. Help us to remember that today, that no matter what we see on the news, no matter what we see out in this world, God,
that's right,
you have given us a place to be ambassadors. You have given us the keys to heaven. And we hold the keys to heaven,
yes,
through
thank you,
Jesus. And that we don't have anything to be afraid of, because you have given us a promise of a hope and a future in you.
Hallelujah.
A promise for today, tomorrow, and forever. God, we thank you right now that anyone here who is feeling anxious about the state of our world, the state of our government, the woes that we daily face, God, we pray, Lord, that you would just heal them right now and touch them, God.
Hallelujah, yes, Jesus.
You would heal them, God, that you would transform them by the renewing of their mind. We thank you for every person in here who has family and friends who are living in bondage, who are just crippled by these different ailments and crippled by the worldly ways. God, we thank you for deliverance. God, use these people. Use our church. Use them to speak truth over their family, truth over their friends, God. Because sometimes we try to fix it and we try to say all the right things and do all the right things. But Lord, let your Holy Spirit guide us.
Yes, Jesus.
To what to say, what to do, what not to say, what not to do, Lord. And right now, as we prepare our hearts for Christmas and for remembering that over 2,000 years ago, that you were born.
Hallelujah.
You were born so that we would have a hope, so that we would have a future with you, Jesus.
That's right.
That we would have an opportunity to not only live and see eternity, live in eternity and see eternity, but that we could bring this eternity with us wherever we go, God.
Jesus.
We thank you that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. God, I just want to lift up Pastor Joe and Judy right now. Lord, that you would bless them, that you would overwhelm them with your love, God, that every day they have so many things to do, God, and God, help them to balance it all, but help them to trust you and help them to see that they can't do anything without you, Lord. God, thank you for giving them just such love for the people in this church, God. And not just the people in our church, but everywhere. God, we thank you for protecting them. We thank you for taking care of them and all of the people in our church, Lord. We thank you for being with them. We thank you for the people who are home by themselves right now, this shut-ins, God, who haven't been able to come to church. We thank you for going before them, God. And we thank you for encouraging them through your word and through your saints. We also lift up the people who are also just struggling right now and need a special touch from you, Lord. We want to lift up our city, that
yes,
you would you would do an amazing transformation in our
Hallelujah.
City.
Hallelujah, yes, Lord.
That the city of Pittsburgh would be known not just for their three rivers, but they would be known for the river of life.
Hallelujah, yes,
that
Jesus.
Flows,
that's right, yes.
That flows
yes.
down and out and around all the
that's
all
right.
the potholes,
yes.
all the hills that just,
yes,
that just pours yes. into the city, God, that your spirit, it would just be like, it would hover over our city, God, like that,
yes,
like
Lord.
That cloud that followed Israel around, God. That it would, that in the fire, God, that lit their way,
yes,
God. Thank
Lord.
You, Jesus. We also ask, God, that you would be with Be with Joel's family, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
We ask the Lord for no more delay in Jesus' name.
No more delay.
No more delay. We pray for breakthrough. We thank you for divine intervention. God, we thank you for getting them here to Pittsburgh now. Now is the day, Lord.
And now
we thank
is the
you,
day.
God,
yes,
for giving Joel and his family a complete trust, a deeper trust as they trust you and they wait for you, God. But we know that you can do it now, Lord. So we thank you, God, for bringing them home and that they wouldn't go another year without each other, Lord.
Yes.
God, we lift up our country, God, that our country's hearts and their minds would be turned to you, Jesus.
Yes, Jesus.
They would not be hurting, and they would not feel alone, Lord, but they would experience your love. They would experience your goodness, and that your mercy and your truth and your goodness would follow them.
Amen.
All the days of their lives, Lord. Thank you for being with us today, and thank you, God, for this time that we can gather and we can praise your name. And we ask these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Jesus.
Would anyone else who would like prayer please come to the front, and would the intercessors please come forward?
As they're coming this morning, let's all agree together in the prayer of faith that God will touch his people. Feel free to come if you want to be anointed this morning. And maybe there'd be a few that would come and be anointed for those we've mentioned that aren't here this morning. Believe today, our Father, that you are the God who heals us. That by your stripes we are healed today. Love you, Lord. Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my fault and saw my need. He sees your need today. Give it to him today, exchange it. I shall forever lift my eyes to Calvary, to view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous the grace that caught my falling soul. My fault and saw my need. Jesus. You look beyond all of our faults and saw our need. We thank you for your amazing grace today. It'll always be our song of praise. Bought our liberty from sin and sickness and destruction. We don't know why you loved us that much, but you did. Hallelujah. You loved us, Jesus. You stretched out your arms and died for us. Thank you, Lord. And he saw my need. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We worship you today.
Today's scripture reading is from Deuteronomy 18:15. Yahweh your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your midst,
Amen.
From your brethren. Him you shall hear.
Yes.
And I thought of.
I knew you had to say something there. I picked that because it for you today. Isn't that a powerful scripture? Amen.
It is.
Amen.
Well, in Hebrew, the word Shema.
Yes.
Means to listen,
yes,
or to hear. And the words of the Shema, it says, Shema Yisrael Adonai, Eloheinu Adonai Echad. And that means, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one.
Yes.
And it goes on to say how you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and your mind.
Yes.
But it's, I think that, I know I struggle with not always listening. Mm-hmm. I don't always hear the Lord.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's such a good reminder, because it's saying here that there will be someone who comes from your midst,
yes,
you know, from your brethren, a,
yes,
a fellow Israelite,
yeah,
a person that they will hear. So I just encourage all of us today to hear what the Lord has to say.
Yes, amen.
And Lord, we thank you for this offering. We thank you, God, most importantly, for us to offer our hearts to you.
Yes.
Because from our hearts flow the springs of salvation.
Yes, Jesus.
And God, we just want to be generous. We want to have a generous spirit because you are so generous to us, Lord.
Yes, Jesus.
And you are a good, good Father who only gives good gifts.
Amen.
We thank you for blessing this offering in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Would the ushers come forward for the tithes and offerings, please?
thank you for that generous offering. And I believe, did Christoph, the slides for the Compassionate Ministries, is it up next, or did we kind of get it for the orphanage? Sorry about that. That's actually my mistake. So you did have it the right place, Jude. During that whole thing, she's telling me that I goofed it up. And so, well, you know, your wife is usually right. Okay, right? Right, Brian? He's not so sure. Well, Brother Joel, I do apologize. I had it. I thought it was next. You come on up, okay? And you'll see in the bulletin, this is, take out the blue sheet there, okay, the blue sheet. This is our Compassionate Ministries project for our holiday season, okay, Brother Joel?
Thank you, Pastor Joel, and thank you all, my church. If there's anything else I would say, what a blessing to have a church with a compassion hearts.
Mm, yes.
Compassion, people don't understand the meaning of compassion. Mm-hmm. Compassion, it goes, you know, beyond the love. Mm-hmm. It goes, when somebody is in pain, you feel the pain. Mm. When somebody is in joy, you rejoice with that person. So I just want to highlight some few things that the Lord has blessed this church abundantly.
Yes.
And the church is reaching out even with the little mega resources that we have. We are reaching out to help the needs of the people across the world. And the Lord has placed to us, you can look how beautiful. That house doesn't look like my house. It doesn't look like your house. Because it looks old. It is not finished. And the children, they look healthy. Despite of all, if you hear the stories inside that house, it's difficult. Let's look into the other slide. For this time, I just want to brief you that these are the main pressing needs of the children. Mm-hmm. The children need mattresses. And you see, 267.00 is not the cost of one mattress. It is the cost of mattress that will accommodate the 14 children. It's not only one. Mm-hmm. If we give generously, we can be able to provide a place for these children to sleep. They don't have blankets. They don't have bed sheets. They don't have anything. And the sheets that you see is $67. Do you know how much $67 in our country today, how much we spend? Mm-hmm. That can buy you only one blanket here. And that is not only one blanket. And it's going to cover the children that we are talking about.
Right.
And also, they don't have towels. Mm-hmm. And the cost of the towel for all the children is $39. They don't have anywhere to sit. Mm-hmm. They sit on a plastic sheet. Mm-hmm. You saw from the last week's presentation, they were sitting on the floor. Mm-hmm. And then the cost of the sitting carpet costs $33 that can be able to accommodate the children. They go bare feet. They don't have any sandals. The sandals are all old and torn. They use a piece of string to tie it from the back. And the cost of the sandals for all these children is $27. And also they don't have chairs to sit on. The cost of the plastic chairs, the $78 that you see in the presentation, is not a one chair. Is the cost of all chairs for the children. Mm-hmm. I just want to beg you and ask you generously to give that we can be able, not even to provide everything that I listed, but even if we can just provide a quarter of it, it will be a blessing to them. Next slide. Last Sunday, Because I came here and I stood and I talked and I gave you the presentation and you saw from the bulletin and you saw on the screen, you heard the cry of the children. And you build the bridge to reach to Uganda. Mm. Because we are a city of bridges, not bridges of the world, but city of bridges that we will bridge to the kingdom.
Amen.
And we gave. Wholeheartedly, we gave $291.
Amen.
And here is the check. And I am going to send this money tomorrow for the most pressing needs. I will not tell them that to do this because they know what is the most important needs. Mm-hmm. And I'm just standing in front of you right now. If the Lord puts any other coin in your pocket, please spare that coin, so that we can reach out to the needs of these children. These children, even, they don't have Bibles. Mm-hmm. A cost of a Bible, one Bible is about $10, which is very expensive in Uganda. Mm-hmm. And if you have some Bibles that you would like to give us, you are also most welcome. You can give it to us, mm-hmm. and then we can ship them. Mm-hmm. This is only my plea to you. And you have on the envelope, and this month, this is now our second giving for compassion. It is, if you want to give to the orphanage, just give it, mark it Compassion Ministries, and then you can just highlight orphanage. That way, the money will come to the church, or if you want to make a check, write it, Lincoln Place Church of the Nazarene, Compassion Ministry, and then you put a little bit orphanage. That, so that we don't get confused, because we have too much going on in this church. I'm telling you. But I even get confused what to do. But because we are the people of God, and God placed us with love and compassion, may the peace of God continue to be with you and provide you. And thank you very much.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Joe. And he's right. There's a lot. If you take a look at that offering envelope, you'll see how many things we are involved in. Okay, there are a lot of things we're involved in. So please do mark it. Hopefully you already put it in the offering plate. If you did not put it in the offering plate, feel free to go ahead and fill that out. And right afterwards, before the counters come get it, just stick in the offering plate, okay? And then it'll go up, and we'll take it up next week. We actually raised enough money to buy the mattresses last week. So that's good news, isn't it, huh? And then we got another, I think, $100 donation this week. So we're well on our way to providing for the needs of these children. Let me tell you, what they have is so, so, so little. And so I just encourage you to please give generously during this time that we are so blessed to have what we have in this country. Just by way of just a couple of announcements, speaking of giving, you know, you may not be aware of this, but, you know, whether you're on, like, Amazon these days or using PayPal, whatever, you can actually designate a charitable organization that you want to contribute to. I actually got a check this past week from PayPal. I was surprised somebody had designated us as their charitable organization. So a percentage of what you actually spend, they will give back to us. And so it's PayPal, it's Amazon, it's others, and all you have to do is just log on there and you can choose your organization. And we're listed there, and if not, then you can include us there. So I just encourage you to do that. And then also, by way of announcements, let's take a look at our bulletin inserts very quickly. If you don't already have enough to do during this holiday season, let me give you a few more things to do. Okay. This coming Wednesday, we are going to be having our caroling. And so it goes like this. Caroling this Wednesday, we're going to be caroling at our shut-ins, those who are not able to get out, and we're delivering our Christmas gifts to them. If you like to carol, we're going to leave the church at 6 o'clock sharp. 6 o'clock sharp. So please, we're going to carpool right here in the Munn Hall area at Lincoln Place and across the river. So a number of people want to visit, but we are expecting a snowstorm, okay? But it's always nice to carol in a little bit of snow, okay? It's always nice to do that. So unless it's like really, really bad and treacherous, we will still be going. That leads me to the second thing is we do not cancel services in Lincoln Place Church Nazarene just for a little bit of snow, okay? So we do cancel services on an occasion. I think like the last 30 years, I may have canceled maybe two services because of weather, okay? So unless you get a call saying the services are canceled, we are meeting, okay? We are meeting, all right? So 6 o'clock Wednesday, caroling, I encourage you to be here and join us. On Thursday, Brother Jim, we are having our band of brothers, Men's Ministries Christmas dinner Christmas party. So I encourage you, if you did not sign up last week, sign up this week. We announced it Friday. We moved it to Thursday because of this next thing, and that is our Messianic congregation is having a Jewish Christmas concert on Friday. So Jim is going to be passing out the sign-up sheet again, okay? And so please, this is for all men, okay? Any age, if you are a male, and yes, we believe there's only two genders, male and female, okay? Only two. If you are a male, okay, any age, right, Jim? You can join us. It's going to be fun. Okay, so that's on Thursday. Jewish Christmas concert on Friday, okay? And then Christmas Eve, notice 6:30 Christmas Eve, this will be our candlelight service as well as communion. So I encourage you to plan to be here for that. One other nice thing is on Saturday the 19th, if you want to still be a witness during the Christmas season at a Planned Parenthood, as you know, we are praying for an end to abortion in America, and we are down there all the time praying and seeking deliverance for those children. They're going to be caroling. I love this. Caroling at 9 a.m. on December 19th. That's a morning time. You may be able to do that. Saturday morning, 9 a.m., Planned Parenthood. And let's just pray that God will even use this season to speak to women's hearts about not aborting their children. I'd like for us to continue the thought that I began last week, and that is Zechariah's song and prophecy found in Luke chapter 1. If you would turn to Luke chapter 1, verses, let's start with verse 67. Let's read it again. Verse 67, Luke chapter 1. Now his father Zechariah, that is John the Baptist's father, was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, "Blessed is the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets, who have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to redeem his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our lives. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the highest, for you will go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, with which the day spring from on high has visited us, to give light to those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. So the child grew and became strong in spirit and was in the desert till the day of his manifestation to Israel." I was beginning the thought last week about divine visitations, and I fleshed out for us the fact that the Savior, the Messiah, would be the horn of salvation, the plentiful, strong salvation or Savior, and that the sunrise from on high would visit us. And I said today that I would present to you what happens when God visits. What happens when God visits? So this is part two of this message, when God visits. Now, I want to list for you seven things that are affected when God visits. Now, this is not a total of everything that happens, but these are seven particular things that you can be sure of that is affected when God visits us. The horn of salvation, that strong, plentiful salvation, and the sunrise from on high will touch at least, let me say, these seven areas that desperately need touching right now in our lives and in our society, in our culture, in our nation. Number one, refocusing occurs. When God visits, refocusing occurs. The first thing that is in every divine visitation is a refocusing that instantly, suddenly occurs. Let me tell you things, if you don't know it already, things are out of focus today, not just in the church. And there's a lot in the church that's out of focus. You agree, right? Amen? But, my friends, there's also a lot of things that are out of focus in this world. Let me say this, that sometimes we get confused as to what the real issues are. And we need to learn to distinguish what is merely fruit, that is what you see, and understand the difference between that and what is at its root. Too often we get caught up in and we make a fuss over what really is fruit, those incidental things, when we really have failed to lay hold of the root of the issue and uproot it. It's time we uproot what's really going on. Let's not worry so much about the fruit. Let's uproot what's really going on and cast it down. Because when Jesus comes and says, the axe is laid to the root. And that's what needs to happen. You see, when the sun rises from on high, brings the light of truth to bear upon our situation, then things come into focus. Remember, I preached long and hard about that, that when Jesus comes, he changes your focus. You really begin to see what really is important. Let me tell you, many people in the church have things out of focus today. They find it impossible to focus on the things that God himself focuses on. I believe that the church is pouring countless of hours of energy and multiplied millions of dollars into things that simply don't matter. They just don't matter. What we need, my friends, is a divine visitation where everything comes into focus. All of us today need to ask ourselves, am I in focus? Am I in focus? Are the things that are on God's heart the things that are on my heart? Are the words that I speak the word of God? Am I speaking from his heart to my heart to your heart? Or am I just rambling on? I hope I'm not rambling on today. You see, our study of Scripture must be intense to draw us near to the heart of God so that what burdens him is what burdens us and will powerfully impact the church. The B-I-B-L-E. Come on. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. There is no other book. There's nothing else that matters. The Word of God is the Word of God. Amen? Come on, church, wake up. It's time to wake up. Number two, holiness. Holiness. The second issue that is always incredibly affected by a divine visitation is holiness. How have we in the church managed to divorce a life of holiness from righteousness with Christ? How can we have righteousness accredited to our account and yet live sinful, pagan lives without any regard for holiness? I say you can't do it. How can it be in this state that we have found ourselves that nominal Christianity is what is called Christianity, and Christianity, which is really about holiness unto the Lord, is regarded as fanaticism? I say let's get fanatical about God again. How can it be, my friends? How have we let that happen? Oh, for a divine visitation that brings the issue of holiness into focus in our lives so that we truly believe, be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. Leviticus 11:44. I say we must take seriously the issue of holiness. When God comes in, I can tell you one of these urgently needed, marvelous visitations, holiness rises immediately to the forefront. You realize just how short you are coming up, and you need to get holy before God. Let's cry out to a holy God, just like Isaiah did. Woe is me, I am undone. I am a man of unclean lips and an impure heart. Depart from me, O holy God, because I am unworthy. Oh, for another day when the horn of salvation will uproot the love of sin out of our hearts and the sunrise from on high will shine upon us so that every speck of sin within us is brought to light and our repentance takes on depth and urgency so long needed. And finally, by the grace of God, he will accomplish holiness in our heart and lives. Amen? Amen. Three, toleration of sin. You can't deal with holiness without dealing with sin. You got to deal with the problem of sin. You see, tolerance of sin is affected when there is a divine visitation. David says in Psalm 51, against you, you only have I sinned, O God, and done what is evil in your sight. My friends, when we have become tolerant of sin, it's because we fail to regularly keep in front of us who our sin is really against. You ask yourselves, how could it be that David's sin is against God only? Didn't he sin against Bathsheba? When he sinned against his family? When he sinned against her husband? When he had sinned against the nation? When his sin was against his own body sexually? How could he say that his sin was only against God? You and only you have I sinned against. It is because, my friends, he understood something that we easily forget, that the great evil of sin consists in the fact that sin is ultimately and really only against God. It's against God. Because you see, when God seems far away, when it's been a long time since we have sensed his visitation among us, we can forget that all sin is really against him. But when God shows up, when God visits us, it becomes so clear that the great evil of our sin is simply in the fact that it is against God that I have sinned. I have broken his commandment, my friends. All sin is against his sovereignty. He is the ruler and not us. All the rights are his. It's not ours. He is the one who has declared the commandments. Thus saith the Lord. The Lord is the one who tells us what is right and what is wrong. Oh, my friends, he's the one who's declared it. He is the one who has stated what is acceptable and what is unacceptable conduct. I love those billboards a few years back when they put a commandment and it says, God, what don't you understand? Thou shalt not, what don't you understand? What don't we get about this? It's God who makes the rules, we don't. You know what the problem with the church is? We made up our own rules. We made up our own rules, and we've done whatever we want to do. That's the problem. See, the answer in our society is found in the church. I keep telling you, the answer is not in the State House, the White House, the courthouse. It's found in God's house. Get God's house cleaned up, and it changes society, I'm telling you. When we sin, it is as if we shake our fist in God's face and we say, I'll just do as I please. You're not sovereign, and I'm not concerned about it. I'm in control of my life. Good old Frank Sinatra. Some of you remember him? Some of you are old enough to remember Frank Sinatra. And what was his song? I did it my way. Who said that? Who said that? Was there a young person that said that? Oh, well, you're not too young anymore, Rich, I'm sorry. Number four, repentance. A visitation is absolutely guaranteed to affect our view of repentance. My friends, we are living in an age where multitudes of people will not even use the word repentance. I preached on this a couple weeks ago, didn't I? But when God draws near, repentance becomes a very urgent issue. You can't deal with holiness without dealing with sin. And the only way you deal with sin is to repent. You gotta repent. We talked about it in Sunday school, didn't we, Jim? You gotta repent. Old-fashioned Holy Ghost conviction comes upon you. You realize you're a sinner because God tells you so. And you gotta repent of your sin. When God draws near, repentance becomes a very urgent issue. I was sharing in Sunday school, when the Holy Ghost came on me that day and I knew that I was a sinner, I knew if I didn't get to that altar and repent of my sin, I was just going to drop dead. That's how urgent it was. I had to take care of it. You do not keep making excuses or pushing it aside. It is something that you know that you're going to have to do and you must do quickly because Otherwise, you're in eternal trouble. And there is no escape. It is appointed unto men once to die, and then the judgment. My friends, when the sunrise from on high visits us, all the church of God needs to hasten to repent. It's time the church starts to repent of its sin and get right before God. And oh, that might happen very soon, right? Amen? Come on, pray with me. Yes, Lord, I'm praying that you will cause your church to repent of its sin. We have lost our first love. We have gone our own way. Forgive us, O God. Forgive us of our sin. Heal our land. Heal our land, O God. Please do it and bring back holiness. Holiness. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Number five, leadership of the Holy Spirit. When a divine visitation occurs, submission to and delight, you're delighted to be under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. The words of John the Baptist will then be multiplied. John said these words, "As for me, I baptize you in water for repentance, but he who comes after me will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire." Come on, church. The baptism in fire is a baptism of purity and passion. Oh, that the sunrise from on high will visit us, and that every person is baptized with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Right? Right? That every person might know power and purity and passion as the Holy Spirit does such great work in and through us. You got to have power, but you only have power if you have purity. And you only have purity when you have passion for God, that God is all that matters. And then number six, when that happens, this happens, you get a fresh love. A fresh love. Come on. Fresh love. Divine visitations. Number six, divine visitations always lead to fresh love. Jesus said about the church at Laodicea, he says what? You've left your first love. You've given up on me. You know what it's like, my friends, when you fall in love with Jesus all over again. You can't get enough of Jesus. Hey, I don't ever want to get enough of Jesus. I want to fall in love with Jesus over and over and over again. You want to spend all the time you can possibly spend with the one who loves you so much that he gave up his life for you. No sacrifice is too great for Jesus. Are you willing, my friends, even in these dark days and these troubled times we found ourselves, are you willing to stand up for Jesus? Are you willing to count the cost? Are you willing to do it? Do you love Jesus that much? Because he loved you that much. Oh, my friends, when there is a divine visitation from on high, there is love. There is a bathing love. Love for God, love for one another, love for a lost world all around you. Let's pray for a fresh love for Jesus today. And then finally, number seven, devotion to work. A devotion to work. You think this is an odd one, but my friends, when the sunrise from on high visits us, there is a devotion to work, not the dead works that are so much part and parcel of the church today, but that work which is truly anointed by the Holy Spirit and is used mightily by a mighty God, right? Come on. The church, my friends, oh yes, the church is buried under dead works. Let me tell you, the church in America, it's buried under dead works. You wouldn't know there was anything different between the church and the world out there. It all looks the same to me. I'll tell you, we are buried under dead works. Oh, for visitation from on high that gives life to all that we are doing. Every important reformation and change that has ever occurred in our society, whatever great awakening or outpouring you are talking about in our society, came as a result of a divine visitation when everything came into focus on God. We turned our backs on everything else and we put our eyes upon Jesus. And I say right now, we are ready for another divine visitation like we have never seen before. Jim and I were talking, you know, and we got to pray that when that balloon bursts, and I think it's going to burst very soon, When it bursts, it's going to be an outpouring of God's Spirit that changes this whole society, this whole culture. Otherwise, we might as well give up, right, Jim? We might as well give up. I tell you, we need this outpouring. We need it so bad. We need this visitation so badly that nothing else really matters. We must lay aside everything that is extraneous. We must reach the point that we cannot live without the immediate presence from the horn of salvation and the sunrise from on high. We got to get desperate. We got to live in desperation for a mighty outpouring of God's Holy Spirit. And I'm praying that not only people that are here today, but people that are listening out there, would you join me? Now is not the time to shrink back. Now is not the time to live in fear. Now is the time to stand up and to count the cost. Amen? Amen. Would our praise team and musicians come? Would you come back, please? Are you ready? Are you ready for the outpouring that is coming? Are you ready to receive it? Are you ready to surrender all to Jesus? Would you stand with me? Let me pray a prayer over us this morning. We're going to sing a beautiful hymn of the church, All to Jesus. And when we sing that, I just want to encourage you, would you feel free to come? And would you gather around the altar this morning? Would you say that I'm ready? I am ready for the outpouring that's coming. I'm ready to receive it. I got to confess my sin. I got to get right with God. I got to repent. I got to get holy before a holy God. I got to get a fresh love. I got to get committed to the work of God. I got to get my focus on Jesus today. Amen? Eyes on Jesus. We honestly believe, Father, that in addition to our desperate need, in addition to our holy longings, the greatest incentive that we could possibly raise before you in a quest for a divine visitation is that your glory that belongs only to you will be rendered in our midst, that we would see you, O God, walking in our midst. Grant, O God, that we will see, that we will experience, that we'll walk in the midst of your presence in your church for the glory of King Jesus and only King Jesus, the sunrise from on high. Amen and amen. Would you come gather as we sing this morning? All to Jesus. Would you come? I just want you to come pray. Just come and pray. Just kneel, stand. It doesn't matter. Just pray. Let's pray. Let's seek his face today. Let's surrender it all to Jesus. Nothing else matters. All that matters is him today.
And all to Jesus I surrender. Jesus, I surrender, Lord, I give myself.
Today, we surrender to you, Lord Jesus. We confess any sin that needs to be confessed. We repent of it. We turn from our wicked ways. We pray, oh God, that you will forgive our sin, that you will then heal our land. I pray, oh God, that you'll just restore your church. There'll be another reformation. There'll be another refocusing, that we'll get our eyes on you, Jesus, and off of this world, that this church will stop looking like the world. It will look like Jesus Christ, because it is your body. We focus on you today, oh God. Give us a fresh love. Renew our love for you. Help us to fall in love with Jesus all over and over and over again. I never want to get enough of you, Jesus. I've had all, but what I need is more of you, Lord. That's what we want, God. We also want to be done with dead works. We're buried under it, God. We want to be set free from those dead works today. We want to be set on fire. We want to be set on fire today, filled with love and the Holy Ghost today. Oh, God, fill us. Fill us, oh, God. We need you so desperately. We need you mightily in our midst today. We need a fresh outpouring, a fresh visitation from on high. We need the horn of salvation to come with plentiful and powerful salvation and deliverance. And we know that the name of Jesus breaks every chain. If there's anything that we're in bondage to, break it off right now, God. And we want to uproot. We want to uproot. And we want to tear down. We want to lay the axe to the root. We want to get rid of that dead and lifeless thing, God. We want to cast it off of us. We want to tear down every idol, oh God. And we want to raise up Jesus Christ today. Oh God, hear our prayer. We are desperate. We are desperate, oh God. Oh, may we hear from heaven. I just hear the Lord say, I hear the Lord say today, return to me. Return to me. Exchange the burden that you're carrying today. Exchange your yoke today. Exchange it. Take my yoke upon you, Jesus says. Learn of me today, Jesus says. Oh, yes, Lord. We hear you today. We want to hear you. We want to hear you today. We want to bow before you, worship you today, oh God. Thank you, Lord. Do a work. Do the work that only you can do. Do your work today. We love you, Jesus. Touch your people. Touch your people today. Oh, Lord. Set your people free. You said that you would come against all of our enemies. I say, let God arise and let his enemies be scattered today. Let God arise. That outpouring that we are so desperately needing, that visitation from on high, we are so desperate for it. A great awakening, a reformation. I don't care what we call it, oh God. We need it so that when the balloon bursts, and it's going to burst, things are going to unravel all around us, that we got to cling only to you, Jesus. Only to you. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. Thank you for touching your people today. We surrender it all to you, Lord. We surrender to you. We do not fear anything or anybody. We don't fear any government or any system. We don't fear any virus. We don't fear anything this world throws at us. We only fear God. We only fear God, who can destroy both body and soul in hell. We don't fear anything else or anybody else. because you are the Almighty. You are El Shaddai today, the Almighty God. We surrender to you, to your sovereignty today. You are in control. Amen. 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 God bless you, church. Go in the power of the Holy Spirit and fire today. Amen and amen. Thank you, Jesus.